two seals and a walrus.
Hey guys, okay, so here we are. We have our alcoholic beverages. We have our merchandise on, including our coffee mugs and our t-shirts that you can get at twosealsandawalrus.com. We got a whole bunch of stuff that you can check out there. We got our Chick-fil-A sandwiches. We got our two co-hosts on the other side of the table, Ben Johnson, Doug Moulton, United States Navy SEALs. And we're ready to talk to you about the cool stuff that's bouncing around in our brains that you know you want. You know you want to understand what's going on in there. I wanted to cover a few things, but I got a big surprise for you guys today because I've blown up on TikTok. And so I've gone into TikTok a little bit into exploring videos and whatnot. And I wanted to share with you some amazing content that I found today that we could just kind of riff on and have fun with. But I wanted to talk about something that happened in media just recently on the Joe Rogan podcast, that Robert Bigelow came on the Joe Rogan podcast and discussed everything but what anyone wanted to hear from him.
Yeah, it was a good interview, minus the avoidance of the topic that everyone wanted to hear.
Right, and if you don't know who Robert Bigelow is, basically I'm saying there was this place called Skinwalker Ranch, which I'm sure everybody's heard about at this point. There's a brand new History Channel documentary that's out in multi-parts on the brand new owner of the place doing some scientific research with some independent scientists who come out and actually try to figure out how to measure things. And they're finding anomalies. They're finding things that they can measure on devices. They're seeing UFOs pop in and pop out of existence based on what the activity that they're doing with exploring that place out there. But the guy who owned Skinwalker Ranch, where all that crazy stuff, where you know cows get mutilated and weird energies occur and UFO sightings are regular and yada yada yada, the guy that owned that place before was this guy named Robert Bigelow. And Robert Bigelow now owns a big aerospace company that has tons of classified contracts for aerospace. They're doing a lot of secret work for the government on things that go out of the orbit or out into orbit. And this guy came on Joe Rogan and said word zero about Skinwalker Ranch. And I thought,
and also the other telling side of that, or I guess the side of it that drives it home, is that Joe Rogan didn't ask a single question regarding Skinwalker Ranch.
Yeah. So now the part of the conversation.
So you know they talked about it prior.
Yeah, you could tell he stayed overnight at Joe's place.
They referenced dinner the night before.
Yep, dinner the night before. Maybe he stayed in a hotel or whatever. But they met, they talked, and then the next day when they had the podcast, Joe Rogan didn't ask one question about Skinwalker Ranch. I was so disappointed. I know everybody else watching who's listening to this who's seen that probably is feeling the same way. Like, what the fuck is going on? Like, for me, I thought it was an exercise of an old man trying to stay away from the non-disclosure agreements of what he could and could not say about certain topics and other influences that may have caused him not to want to have conversations about certain things, but they did not go anywhere near. They talked about aliens. They talked about
dark energy.
Yeah, they talked about a bunch of stuff, and none of it came by Skinwalker Ranch. I was a little nonplussed.
It was a little too obvious to me.
Yeah.
Like, if they wanted to be smart about it, they should have, like, brushed the topic.
Yeah, said something. I mean, if there's something...
The fact that there was zero questions asked, zero items brought up was the most telling.
Yeah, because, I mean, if there's nothing, if you own the place, and Bigelow did scientific research out there on Skinwalker Ranch, that was one reason that he bought the place, is he wanted to find out the science behind what was going on out there. And then he put the scientific discovery process in place and then reported nothing at the end of it. And it was what partially government funded, right? Mm-hmm. The government was partnered with him on figuring out what was going on up there at Skinwalker Ranch and now says nothing about it. Like, at the end of it, like, if there's nothing to say, you just say there's nothing. We didn't find anything, right? No big deal. Or if there's something small, you say, okay, well, here's what we found. And, you know, it was interesting.
But you don't make zero mention with zero questions asked during a 3-hour interview.
Right.
About something that someone spent millions on in years of their life.
Yeah.
And recent history, too. It's not like this happened 50 years ago. This was a few years ago that it ended.
Yes. Yes. I mean, there's an eyewitness to everything that happened with Robert Bigelow sitting across from you in your Joe Rogan podcast studio, and you ask zero questions about that.
Yep.
Wow. Why?
Well, to me, at first I was like, what the fuck? And then I was like, oh my God, they found something.
Yeah.
They found something tangible.
Totally. either that or there's the other side of that coin is like look at everything in shades of gray. We talked about this before. There's always a realm of possibilities that I never rule out any one of them, but I look at the big ones of probabilities and say it's either got to be this or this because these are the biggest two chunks and there's other stuff out here that could have happened. But I see, you know, a guy trying to avoid getting in trouble with non-disclosure agreements, certainly, as a possibility. I also see a possibility of someone who got exposed to some experience that scared the shit out of him so much that there is no way you want to even approach the topic for whatever reason.
But it had to be discussed prior. Otherwise, Joe, the interviewer, would have asked.
Yeah.
They covered everything else. There's no way it wasn't discussed prior.
Yeah. Yeah. And I wonder what that conversation was. I would have loved to have been a fly on the wall to find out what, why, or even how Robert Bigelow possibly proposed or framed not talking about it, period, in the face of somebody who invited him on the show undoubtedly to say, you used to own Skinwalker Ranch, what's up?
Yeah.
Right? And then none of it is covered.
They could have found a bunch of pictures with Joe Rogan, like, diddling kids or something. And he's been like, hey, what'd you find in Skinwalker? Like, all scared about it. And then Robert Bigelow was like, oh, yeah, you wouldn't know. And he's like, yeah, we'll just not talk about that then.
I mean, I guess that could have happened.
It could have. It's possible. I don't think Joe Rogan diddles kids. But, no. But if we're talking about, you know, options, he might have got his questions answered and neither one of them were interested to hash it out.
I think the likely scenario is that something tangible was found or discovered
photos
that then evolves into a government-funded project which was able to wrap around a veil of non-disclosure.
Yeah, that's logically the most reasonable assumption.
I just thought our clickbait headline for this show. Does Joe Rogan diddle kids?
Probably not, but we're going to talk about it anyway. Sorry, because it's clickbait and your audience is retarded. Yours as in everyone's. No, I'd rather watch the news and get real news.
Well, I was so caught up with the documentary that the History Channel put together with the new owner, who's, you know, supposedly a billionaire. He owns a Lamborghini or whatever, and they showed him driving in the first episode. He flies helicopters everywhere, so he's got some money, and he bought it from Robert Bigelow. And you got to figure it's probably millions of dollars for that property out there. They're making a documentary, and it was so good. I mean, they found him a center of energy. An energy source that was like a mile up above the ground. They did triangulation with these measurement devices and whatnot, and then they sent a weather balloon up through this point that was exactly 1 mile up or about a mile up, and the weather balloon disappeared, and the really reliable measurement devices that send code wirelessly and all the information wirelessly disappeared and quit sending information when it got up to that elevation, and they didn't ever recover any of the gear, the weather balloon or the devices or anything. And these have like GPS information on them, so where you can just go track them down wherever they land. None of that occurred when they sent this thing up through there. And then they saw UFOs, like on film, they saw UFOs in this documentary, like within minutes of them sending that weather balloon up through that energy source a mile up, and they caught it on camera. And so it was amazing. And I was like, oh my God, that's awesome content that I hope they do another couple, 3 years worth of episodes to explore that more, because it's amazing. And now we're going to talk about the guy who started it all with the scientific research of Skinwalker Ranch, and he comes on Joe Rogan, who's amazing at getting information out of anyone, and they say nothing.
I was holding my breath that entire interview, being like, oh, I can't wait to hear this. And then like I realized there was like 20 minutes left, and I was like, oh man, they're not going to talk about this.
Yeah. Yeah, you got to the point where Robert started talking about non-local consciousness and Joe not obviously being exposed to the remote viewing science of Russell Targ and Hal Puthoff, and the ability for people to look through non-local consciousness into classified military bases and get real world operational intelligence that, you know, special operations forces like yourself can act upon. With psychic spies, like, you know, and all that stuff is, you know, had decades of funding from the government and from intelligence agencies, the CIA, the NSA, NASA, funded these guys for four decades based on a year-to-year assessment. It's not like, hey, we're going to give you another decade of funding. It was like, every year, we're going to look at your results, and then we're going to decide whether to cut you another check. And every year for 40 years, they got another check based on the results that they were getting. One of their top remote viewers was Joe McMonagle, who is the highest decorated civilian in United States history right now. And he was a remote viewer. He was a chief warrant officer in the Army. They did a bunch of tests on psychic ability. They found out that Joe McMonagle was super psychic. And he started telling them about nuclear testing that occurred 3 days prior to when it was going to go off that nobody knew about. And then all of a sudden they go and they put a satellite there and boom, a nuclear test occurs 3 days later when Joe McMonagle said it was going to happen. They had a psychic who identified the downed location of a Russian bomber, where the pilot punched out early, the jet had fuel to keep going, and everybody, all the intelligence agencies for the world were looking on one side of the country in this West African nation, and the plane actually flew farther and went down in this other portion of the West African nation. No one knew that except for the psychic who gave him the exact coordinates on the map to say, go look here. They landed, that CIA landed the helicopter there and saw the natives pulling the wreckage out of the jungle of the downed aircraft. And we were the first there. And Carter blew the cover on that by talking about it on a speech in Emory and basically outed the whole program that was completely classified up until that point. And then finally the CIA declassified a lot of the documents. Russell Targ came out and said, yeah, we've been running a psychic spies program for a number of years at Stanford Research Institute. You need a top secret classification to even get into the place. And so Joe Rogan's obviously not heard of any of that science, because he and Bigelow were having that argument at that time about, Bigelow was like, well, I wonder about non-local consciousness, or about, you know, whether consciousness exists after the human body, and we're trying to do that study. And Joe was like, there's no evidence anywhere ever, blah, 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 blah. He's like taking the whole materialist line because he's obviously not privy to the science that's been done on that. That's pretty conclusive that, yeah, actually non-local consciousness is a thing. Consciousness is fundamental to physics, and here's how all that stuff can work in quantum mechanics if you're looking at quantum mechanics from the right perspective, not from the materialist view that most people take. And I thought it was a big disappointment from that perspective, that they devolved into that, you know, argument of Joe not knowing the science of what Robert was talking about, and Robert talking about science is well advanced over what typical physicists are working with today. And then it just kind of resolved into, we're never going to talk about Skinwalker on this episode. And I was just like, that's bullshit, because that's the only reason that anybody tuned into this episode at all is because Robert Bigelow owned Skinwalker, and we want to find out what the fuck happened 2 decades ago when he was doing the scientific research.
If you want to find out the truth, you need to wait like everybody else and get it from reality TV.
It's laughable, but it's true. What's interesting about that show? God, what is the name of that show though? The Secrets of Skinwalker Ranch, that's on Discovery.
Something like that. Yeah.
It was like one of the second or third to last episode of this first season that's out. The NASA engineer, they spent however many weeks there. They break off to see their families, and they come back. When they come back, he divulges that a representative from a government agency approached him about what they were doing.
Right.
I thought it was interesting that they even just, he was out with that.
Yeah.
Because you know that part of that had to have been part of the conversation from that representative that was like, hey, I want you to be open about this.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think a lot of this, you know, and we all have to dance this line, right? We have all had high clearances in the past. We've all dealt with things that we cannot share with the regular public until a non-connected,
so you get it revoked and then kicked out, and then it doesn't matter, right guys? Until you're a security risk and they seize your clearance and they stop paying you. And
no, but until something happens in the regular press, right? Like if another source leaks a piece of information that you are connected with, now you get an opportunity to talk about it because it's something that has been released out into the wild, right? Like, you can't talk about things that haven't been released out into the wild, but at the point that either, like, something has to happen, either it's declassified and the classification changes on what the stuff you were working on, which hasn't changed for any of the stuff that I used to work on, which is crazy. Or something is leaked in, like, the UFO thing. Nobody could talk about UFOs until the Pentagon and the United States Navy released their videos and said, yeah, these are unidentified aircraft that we don't know who they are. We're pretty sure that they're not Chinese or Russian. We don't know what they are, but at the same time... And then all of a sudden, everybody and their brother, who had previous clearance on, you know, the visibility, started coming out and saying, yeah, we agree. This stuff is unexplainable, and we can talk about it now because it's been released in the new, you know, I'm talking about something that happened in the New York Times, right? You have that door that you can talk about classified stuff. I don't know. I think he's been locked up, and I think there's, from a certain extent, it's been open that when he owned Skinwalker Ranch, there was some kind of a military involvement, and I think that was disclosed, and I think he can talk about that. But all the other stuff, I think I agree with Doug that it was wrapped up in a big old NDA. Mm-hmm. It was probably by design, where the government came in and said, if we cut this guy a check, we can keep all this shit secret.
Yep.
And
it allows, my assumption or hypothesis is that it also allows Robert Bigelow to further go down the path that he's always wanted to and research certain things.
Exactly.
Because it's a win-win for him. He just has to not be open about something.
Because Bigelow Aerospace is now getting huge contracts, huge classified contracts for aerospace projects.
Yeah.
It's like,
after he buttoned up things at Skinwalker Ranch and didn't talk about it, it's like, come on.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not a rocket surgeon, but, like, something happened. You know what I mean? I can see the writing on the wall.
I bet if he got his dick cut off and started prancing around in a dress, the news would cover everything.
Probably.
Yeah. And then the government couldn't kill them because then they would be intolerant.
That's true.
We might even nominate him for Nobel Prize for being so fucking brave.
All right, so the government now has a hand in ruining Joe Rogan podcast episodes. Thank you very little.
See, what I don't get about that whole thing is, like, he's on there and we all want to know about Skinwalker Ranch. Why not just bring up Skinwalker Ranch and give the same generic, you know, oh, we didn't really find anything that they've been given for years?
And that's the only thing that leans me towards him being absolutely terrified by whatever happened, whatever his experience was at Skinwalker Ranch, because that would be the only other thing that I would think that, you know, yeah, you downplay it, but he doesn't want to talk about it at all. And so it's like, did something horrible happen out there? Was there some type of experience?
Well, you know, they had cages where they would put cattle.
Yeah.
There were small cages. They were like, you whatever, 20 feet by like 50 feet rectangles.
Yeah.
And they had an observation post stand above it. And they had cameras not only looking inward on this pretty small rectangle, but looking outward.
Mm-hmm.
And it's super eerie when you see how they set up this testing in the new documentary.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a little dark.
It was super dark.
Yeah.
Like, when I saw that, and they kind of were like, oh, yeah, they used to put animals in here and see what would happen. I was like, what, stop? Like, what? Didn't see what would happen?
And you guys were shocked when your llamas got fucking mauled in those cages.
Right.
Like, oh, can you believe it? They attacked it. It's like, God, yeah. Okay. They got attacked in the cage next to where your animals have been getting attacked that you set up.
What's creepy, though,
stage them for being attacked?
I don't know. What's creepy, though, is the one where a cow actually gets mutilated. And the cow is in view of one of their security cameras that's recording real time, 24/7, and recording. And in the video, this is so creepy. You see, like, the herd of cows leave. This cow is still laying here. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty far away, but you can make out that it's a cow. It's kind of near this tree. And it goes to get up, and it lays back down real quick.
Yeah.
But, like, it doesn't look like it wanted to.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, in the same field of view, you can see an object in the sky appear.
Yeah.
And then you can't see on the camera anything other than the cow just kind of lay back. And the cow never gets up. They have complete footage of it.
Yep.
And when they go over to it, it is mutilated. But you can't see the mutilation happen in the video. It just lays down and doesn't move.
Yeah. Crazy stuff. I mean, you got to check out the documentary on History Channel to bring yourself up to speed if you're not up to speed on that stuff. You had some interesting thoughts on, they screwed up the thermal imaging portion of their...
Oh, yeah. They use thermal imaging sensors attached to drones just just to, you know, the whole point of thermal imaging is to see if you can identify any anomalies. And then the whole point of that is to see if those anomalies mean anything or not, right? Yeah. So it's not necessarily when you're doing a thermal imaging inspection, and I used to do thermal imaging inspections, and I'm actually a certified thermographer. When you're doing a thermal inspection, the intent necessarily isn't to prove something you know. It is to see if there's any anomalies, then to investigate those anomalies.
Yeah.
And the problem is they did it, and if you don't understand the characteristics of thermal properties to different materials, you shouldn't be fucking around with thermal cameras, because it's not like using an RGB camera, which is just a regular like film or digital camera.
Yep.
It's not capturing the same information. It is capturing completely different information.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what you're trying to, if you're trying to find a small delta in temperature,
yeah,
and you're not considering the exact time of day, the environmentals, the weather in the last 3 days, just fuck off, because you're not doing it right.
Right. And so you've got some ideas on how they can improve that and actually find some stuff.
There's a few tests that I would have done. You know, I would akin it to how you would do a thermal imaging inspection for a roof, right? So what you would, the whole goal is to find something anomalous, right? You want to find deltas in temperature that maybe shouldn't be there.
Yeah.
That allow you to pull a thread further. That's just literally what you're doing a roof inspection for. And when you're doing a roof inspection, you don't just go up in the middle of the fucking day, right? Because since that sun had come up, every piece of material, it's called solar gain, is absorbing solar energy, right? And that emits more thermal radiation, right? So if you're in the middle of the day and the sun's been blasting it all day, which is gaining energy, which is then putting off more thermal radiation, all you're going to see is just warm spots, right? Like, cool. No, dumb. What you need is to understand the material difference, the deltas you're looking for, and you don't need the why. You just need to do it in a time where small deltas will appear. So one of the things I would have done, and again, similar way you set up a thermal imaging inspection for a roof, is you wait for the right weather. So I would wait for a heavy, heavy rain.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say it rains on a Monday, right? I would wait. So it rains all day Monday. Before sunrise on Tuesday, before sunrise, like a couple hours before, I would then throw up my thermal imaging cameras. Because what happens is when you soak material,
mm-hmm.
doing it at night, you're removing the variable of solar gain, right?
Right.
Because the guys that use drones in the documentary did it in the middle of the day where the sun is raging there, right?
Right.
It's I think they're like a mile elevation and the sun's been up, no clouds. It's like, yeah, you're going to see everything the sun has just been adding thermal gain to. Like, so anyways, you wait for rain. You do it before sunrise because the reason you wait for rain is the same reason why firefighters use water to fight fires.
Right.
Not necessarily because it smothers fire, because it pulls heat out of things, right?
Right.
So like a roof, right? If you do a thermal imaging inspection a couple days after it rains and you do it before sunrise, the building itself is heated. So you have to know your assumptions, like we're talking about this earlier. You have to know your assumptions. You're saying, hey, there's something anomalous that's creating heat.
Yes.
That we can identify. Yeah. So let's be aware of our assumptions. Sorry. Yeah. That's one of my assumptions here is that there's something that we're going to identify that's putting off heat in areas that we don't know.
Yeah.
So if it rains on a Monday and you wait until just before sunrise on a Tuesday, and if you assume that maybe there's something generating thermal energy, all where there's water and there's thermal energy that's not from the sun, it's going to be glaring because the water's just going to soak it up, right? It's just going to soak up all that thermal energy.
Yes.
And it'll be so vivid because if you do it, again, before sunrise, anything that doesn't have solar thermal energy being induced to it, it's going to be super fucking cold.
Right.
Anything that has the tiniest bit of thermal energy being put into it is going to be so much warmer than its surroundings. And they didn't do that at all. They just literally threw it up. Like, let's see what the temperatures are. It's like, yeah, you're looking at the temperature of the sun right now.
Right.
That's what you're looking at.
Yeah, and it's reflections from the ground and the rocks and the yada, yada.
Yeah.
And then they found that little cave because it was shaded. Duh.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay. That cave at night would look way different. And the thing is, you can't do it right after sunset because everything is still dissipating the solar gain.
Right.
You have to do it the farthest away from its solar gain point, which is sunset. Which is why you do it at sunrise, because that's going to be where it starts to gain solar energy again. So you have to do it 2 hours before sunrise.
All right, so here's what I want from our viewership. I want you to get on the internet and get this message to someone at Skinwalker Ranch that we could do a better thermal analysis than any of the guys that they've had out there so far. And Doug happens to be an expert in multi-rotors, so he can do the whole thing soup to nuts and get you a better view and better data of what's going on out there to investigate the anomalies at Skinwalker Ranch. Do that for us if you have any inkling of you'd like to know what's going on at Skinwalker Ranch, because Doug says they screwed it up the first time and he'd like a second shot.
Usually. I felt so bad because they're like, oh, we didn't see anything. It's like, oh my God, no shit. I felt so bad for this guy that came in as the pseudo expert. You know, it's like, no, you don't understand what your little sensor is trying to capture.
Right.
It's a range of frequency of photons that we don't physically see. We can feel sometimes if we're close enough, like feeling a hot stove, right? And we're trying to measure it. The thermal camera basically captures that information and puts it into a visualization that we can comprehend. And that is the problem that people don't understand.
Right.
Is that you're collecting photons at a range that we don't really comprehend. We can feel a little bit, but we can't really – technically you can see it because you look at the sun, but it's not really the same – you're not seeing the frequency of photons, and these technologies convert it to an image that we can say, "Oh, I'm now through my range of photons that I visually see as a human, I can now interpret the temperature differentials."
Yeah.
Fucking. It's so simple.
So simple, but not, obviously, because they had somebody that they considered an expert out there who totally was fucking the football on the 50-yard line.
Yeah.
That vet, though, I mean, that guy was pretty competent.
Oh, yeah, the vet guy was competent, and he knew what was going on with the cow. And the other guy that I
because it was scared. Like, you could tell that by licking your finger and putting it
in
its
asshole, die from pneumonia, technically?
Yeah, technically.
It died from sipe.
That was terrifying.
It died from stress-induced pulmonary edema.
Yeah, that was terrifying.
Which happens to people at Bud's.
Yeah.
So either it was Bud's instructors trying to make the cow quit, or or the vet's making stuff up by touching the cow's butthole.
Yep, see right here?
I don't read no good, but this is stress-induced pulmonary edema. What? Okay, yeah, that wasn't coached. What was my line again, guys? All right, yeah, so I'm not really buying anything on the whatever channel. With my first-hand experience in these shows that have the same narrator repeating himself after every commercial break and then recap clips of the same 1.5 minutes of content that was almost exciting.
I will say this documentary.
The same dramatic music behind it.
Yeah, right, exactly.
I saw 48 minutes of 2 minutes of content. I saw a lot of really uncreative editing that is super familiar from Discovery Channel.
And, oh, yeah, you were on Discovery Channel.
I was. And apparently I was a cold, calloused sociopath. They can't make fire or do work.
Yeah, you're just lucky you survived that.
The 20-nothing-year-old chick with zero experience in survival seemed to coerce some level of affection, heal my broken soul, and teach me how to survive ocean.
That's a better story.
It is a better story, because what Navy SEAL knows how to survive at the beach? Yeah, no, as far as I'm concerned, I'll never know what that result of that experiment was. I dig that fucking head scientist methodology, but even he was like, yeah, apparently I got some kind of injury and I'm not allowed to talk about results no more. So doctors say, I was like, that guy's demeanor changed. I'm inclined to believe that whoever tried to big dick him about not talking about it probably got to him too. And that nerdy dude that rented the Lamborghini for his appearance and staged one with a briefcase.
Oh man!
And this hidden rare earth magnet that was obviously bought at the fucking Acme.
They built that up a little too much.
Like, fuck you guys! If y'all wanted anybody seriously,
I was really impressed with that one. I don't know. I think he's an engineer by trade. That one guy that was like, all right, well, here's what we're seeing. Let's try to replicate it. Because if we can replicate it, then maybe there's some commonality.
Right, right.
I thought that was brilliant.
Yeah, I thought it was really preposterous that their solution for finding out data at the, 5,500-foot level was
a balloon.
A fucking thing that apparently happened in Roswell in the fucking 40s.
Yeah.
You guys are this program is still going to default to weather balloon?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would have thought like, they would have done something else.
Like
a drone?
Yeah,
or like anything? Send a skydiver.
But here's
who can
the thing,
check
though.
His fucking activity and fly his canopy through that.
I don't know if I'd want to skydive into there.
Why not?
Well,
if you don't believe in aliens and you're good at skydiving, why wouldn't you?
Because the energy levels, right? There were a couple of
allegedly
things.
Because they couldn't measure it because they used a weather balloon.
That's true.
Yeah,
but they got some measurements for it. Got out.
The other side of it, though, is that there are some electromagnetic anomalies out there that their batteries died and he couldn't fly the drone a second time is because the batteries were dead
and that happened to some other folks.
Hot air balloon. Anchor it to the ground. Float it straight the fuck up on a non-linear.
But you have to have a lot of extra buoyancy to keep the line relatively straight.
Yeah.
Which is why they couldn't do it with the size they had.
Yeah. They were just filling the balloon with helium, right?
Yeah.
Had a little bit of helium, and then that expands after a certain, you know, and plus you can only put a certain amount of helium in there depending on the elevation that you're looking to get to because it can only expand so much, and then it pops, and then it falls at extreme elevation. But... yeah, I'll say this. I want to camp out there at Skinwalker Ranch. I want to go camping. I want to do some science stuff with Doug's leadership on how to do thermal imaging. And if you want three guys or four guys who do not register fear,
four.
I think that's in this room right here because you can't scare the shit out of me for anything. And I'm pretty sure you can't scare the shit out of these guys for anything either. Or at least we productively use fear when it arises within us to make us more efficient than we usually operate at. So somebody make the call out to someone who knows Skinwalker and get us out there on compound because we are dying to get out there and be a part of this thing.
And if the government's watching us and controlling that access, then we won't tell anybody, I swear.
We won't put it on our podcast.
Yeah. No, it was a weather balloon and some spooky ghosts and ectoplasm.
But secretly, we are definitely going to give you everything that we see out there.
All right, let me change the topic for a minute. I got a treat for you guys because in the last number of months, I've kind of blown up on TikTok. And here's my theory on that. Is that TikTok is a place where you can only watch 60-second videos at a time, and that's all you can make, and you better get your content into 60-second videos because that's all that you're going to have. And so the
good
audience...
to ensure the quality.
Right. The audience, as you can imagine, the audience is one where they can only handle, because of the plasticity of the brain changing based on how you use it, form and function, they have reduced their attention span down to less than 60 seconds because they're scrolling through a lot of these things. And the human attention span, by the way, is only 8.5 seconds, where a goldfish is 9. But on this app, this TikTok app, where I've started putting out tips and tricks on how to... manage your brain and manage your mind better. Turns out that I have a target-rich environment of people who are wanting to have tips and tricks on how to control their mind, reduce their stress, reduce their emotional output because their brain is in a state of panic, scrolling every 4 or 5 seconds to the next video.
In a catastrophic state of dysfunction. Right. So they're reaching out to find a few second cure all.
But I will say this. The process was, one of my fans called up and said, you need to have millions of followers. I don't understand what's going on. Have you ever tried TikTok? And then she got us on TikTok and I blew up into, you can see it here on the screen, 274,000 followers so far, and it's growing. It's growing every day. But I had to get into TikTok and start to do a little bit of analysis of what kind of content's on TikTok. And, you know, so I started watching it and whatnot, and I got hooked. This freaking platform is different than all other social media platforms you've ever experienced, and in a positive way. There aren't that many trolls on the site. Don't get me wrong. There are trolls who just want to try to come and ruin your day. But it is such a supportive and interesting and diverse group of creators that it's such a pleasure to go through these videos and then subscribe to somebody or like their videos or whatever. And I wanted to share with you guys some of this stuff because some of this stuff is just kind of funny to riff on. But other stuff is interesting. Like there's this dude here, which I thought because Ben is the head of research at a cannabis company. company, a CBD company in Georgia. There's a dude on here who's got a TikTok
that
is amazing at talking about cannabinoids and different strains of cannabis and different CBD types, and it's just amazing, awesome content. And I wanted to like go through.
All right, some cool new information. Some cool new information just came out about the cannabis industry. I'm going to share it with you. Vape pens were down, tinctures were down, topicals were down, concentrates were down. So were capsules, but edibles, beverages, flower, and pre-rolls were all up quite a bit over last year. The MVP of the show is actually edibles. Edibles were up from $760 million to $1.2 billion, so that's a big increase, the most by any category, and it outperformed the growth in the cannabis industry by a percentage. So,
this guy comes on here, and he makes 60-second videos about the different types of cannabinoids that you can get from CBD products and what's good for this and that, and talks about the science and talks about everything connected with CBD and cannabis, because he runs a cannabis company, I guess, out in California. He's making bank, whatnot, but it's just really cool stuff to be able to get an update from him, who's got his finger on the pulse of what's going on in the cannabis industry. And he's one of the best guys that I've ever seen. And I found him on TikTok. It's pretty amazing stuff. And but you know, the diversity.
All right, check it out. So
is pretty interesting in that you have all different types of creators who come together to put together different types of content up. And so this lady right here that we're looking at does body art, and she does, like, she doesn't use her voice, so she'll lip sync to a lot of other audio stuff. So, but the type of art that she does is fucking amazing.
Ended up on your For You page, which means you like art or you're an artist. I just wanted to show you my work. Look at the detail. I spent many hours on this. I just hope I get one like, a couple of comments, maybe a share.
So she does a, you know, a lip sync of a number of different things that are out on audio, but you could see the
can
level of work that she does with her body.
Can somebody tell me where all the fellow Viking women are?
It's actually
because I'm no skinny.
Yeah,
I'm no
why?
Fat. But I do look like I could destroy your village. Can somebody tell me?
I just came into the party for the drugs. 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 I'm not trying to make a friend or fall in love.
Love.
So just stop the faking. Not here for nameless faces. Pointless talking.
But what about that? Tell me what to do. Wee. Wee. Wee.
So I feel like I've been hearing a lot of people kind of like blow up overnight, like they wake up and they're famous. So when I wake up in the morning and that doesn't happen to me, I remind myself I am a slow cooker, not an instant pot. So I feel
right.
Damn, that'd be dope.
Else chewing on the irony there. She does her videos in fast forward.
Yeah.
Okay. That's awkward.
But here's a, if you like, if you miss the news.
Not a question pilots want to be asking, and for American Airlines Flight 2292, that was just the start of a 15-second communication overheard by radio interceptor Steve Douglas in his airwave capture cave.
When I heard this aircraft, you know, basically above all other aircraft, because the tone in his voice was so excited.
The airline heading to Phoenix when the event happened over the northwest corner of New Mexico.
We just had something go right over the top of us that, I hate to say this, looked like a long cylindrical object. It almost looked like a cruise missile type of thing moving really fast that went right over the top of us.
Talking to an ex-military pilot I know, he says that for them to see this, this object had to be coming at them practically head on. So whatever it was came fast and right at them and right over them, which gave them a big enough scare that they had to report it.
And now that the report is out there, the FAA jumps in.
They meet you at the plane, and then they have to discuss the whole thing and do paperwork.
I wasn't watching the news, and I get this TikTok that pops up in front of me, and then all of a sudden I knew about the airline pilot that had the UFO scare over New Mexico. And you get a quick 60-second synopsis of what's going on. It's pretty interesting stuff, to where you can get news. Like I saw... oh my God! No, I got to show you guys this.
Well, on that one,
and this is the beauty of TikTok, is because you form a thought, and then all of a sudden something else comes up and interrupts you, and it's amazing. So, skydiver.
pull in his front rides and doing low turns like this isn't that.
Holy fuck.
Nice.
That guy's moving.
Oh, dude, I didn't know they'd actually recorded the new army jump sequence.
No, those are static line.
So this is, I guess, the last jump of the day for this guy, and he wanted to do something special.
Holy fuck.
He's moving.
Yeah.
That kid did not
tiny little
good.
Shoot.
That had to hurt. He took a face plant on that ball. So you got these folks, and then you get stupid shit like this.
God damn it, Chug.
Thirsty cow?
Are you fucking kidding me, bro? You're too old for this shit.
He's going right in there.
Alright, breathe. Breathe. Stop it. Breathe. Get your head up. Alright, calm down, but it is. God damn it, Chug.
And you got 2.4 million views down here on the lower right. Or 2.4 million likes.
You're too old for this shit.
One of the things, like, you got cute little videos like this. And like, oh, baby goats. Who doesn't love baby goats, right? But then you run into something like this.
All
right,
guys, let's talk steak Maui. So we have sugar, soy sauce, pineapple juice, apple cider vinegar, ginger, and garlic. We're going to mix it up good, put it on the stove until the sugar is melted, let it cool, get our big cowboy ribeye in there, let it marinate overnight. I'm using my buddy Rodney's new steak rub, season it up good, got the jealous devil running about 225. We're going to let it go until I hit an internal of about 120, 121. Put the grill grates on there. Time to sear this bad boy up. Once you get it all seared up, we're going to bring it inside. We're going to throw some pats of butter on top of it. Tin it with foil. We're going to let it rest for about 15 to 20 minutes. We're going to slice into it. Absolutely perfect. And those flavors are freaking unbelievable. Y'all need to give this a shot. Recipe, ingredients below. Enjoy.
And then it loops. But this guy's got a whole page of how to do meat. Like all the tips and tricks you would ever want to make an amazing barbecue experience are on his page, and they're all less than 60 seconds long. I have been like losing hours of my life at night, every night before I go to bed, by opening up TikTok on my fucking phone and just following where it takes me. And some of this stuff has just been fucking amazing.
So, well, I mean, someone's giggling
laughing
because
at the fact that you're stoked about Billy doing meat and all the tips.
Was it, you just showed a video of a guy doing meat.
Yeah, right before.
This is
bed,
I mean, this is the first time I've looked at TikTok, so
I've never heard of TikTok.
I know you guys are like,
I've never.
You're taking it in, but this is all kind of like this guy.
Dad, what are you doing? I'm watching Scared Straight. This is your episode. You're about to come up after this commercial.
Oh shit!
Here it is.
Yo, my name is Icebox. What the fuck you think your name is?
It's Derek, but you can call me Pretty Princess.
Yeah, I'm calling you Deborah.
I love it. Chad, I'm Deborah now.
And in my cell block, we love fresh fish like you.
I am so fresh.
End up here in prison, and you're gonna shower with all of us, homie.
It's Deborah, remember?
But yeah, sounds amazing. And if I see you back up in here, you're gonna be my girlfriend.
Oh my gosh, yes, we can get matching outfits.
Matching outfits.
And then I can get a tattoo that says Icebox on my shoulder, and then you get one on your chest that says Deborah.
Guards, I'm ready to go back to my cell.
Oh my, yes. Chad, tell Principal Anderson I'm going with Icebox back to his cell. We need candles, probably lilac scented if possible, and I need my phone so I can play my love music playlist.
Come get me, please.
This is gonna be so fun, Chad. Can you also call my dad, tell him I'm staying with Icebox for the night, but I should be home in time for youth group in the morning? Thank you so much.
Derek, what the fuck was that?
It's Deborah now.
So this dude has millions of followers and he makes nothing but those little skits.
So I saw a post about Gerber having metals in their baby food. So I go and pull out my daughter's cereal to take a look, and sure enough.
Welcome to Fact or Cap,
where we test TikTok videos to see if they're real or bullshit.
All right, so I got the Gerber baby food right now, and as you can see, there are tiny bits of metal in it. So I was not expecting this, but there were small amounts of something at least attracted to magnets.
Every time I come, a nigga gotta set it, then I gotta go, and then I gotta get it, then I gotta blow it, and I gotta shut it. Any little thing a nigga think that he be doing, cause it doesn't matter, cause I'm gonna da-da-da-da-da. I'm gonna murder everything and anything about a boom, about a bing. I gotta do a lot of things to make it clear to a couple niggas that I always win, and then I gotta get it again and again and again.
The thing that I love is his expression goes from, ah, this is fun, I love this, to when is this gonna end?
Yeah.
Stop doing this to me. What is this one?
These are the most addicting pickles of your life in 5 minutes.
Two cucumba.
Cut off.
Both ends.
Slice.
Into coins.
Obviously, if you want to do spears, I'm not stopping you.
Place into a 1 gallon mason jar.
Saucepan.
2 cups of white vinegar. 1 cup of water. 1 tablespoon of salt. 1 tablespoon of sugar.
Now for the secret ingredient.
2 teaspoons of MSG.
Onto the stove.
Heat medium hot.
3 cloves of garlic.
Crushed and rough chopped.
As soon as that comes to a boil,
pour over your cucumbers just until covered.
Add your garlic
and your dill.
Let that sit till room temp.
As soon as they're cool, slap on a label.
Lid and keep in the fridge.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Watch your
response. You try this pickle.
Good.
That's it?
It was really yummy. Can I have some more?
Yes.
Probably some more really informative gyms.
Oh, yes!
That's dope.
You gotta wonder how many hours of his life this guy spends.
People come on!
What? People don't filter the output they
put. Yeah!
This is all first tries.
Yeah, totally.
Oh!
I think this guy's single.
Whoa!
This is COVID right here.
That's dope.
Yeah, I mean,
that'd be so much fun.
Yeah!
I mean,
so satisfying.
Come on! Yeah!
The CD thing, that seems like an original kind of.
He can't even see. So you can imagine the types of holes that I go down every night. In these.
That one's really cool, though, because that one hits on one of the new foundations for measuring degrees of intelligence. Like Harvard kind of threw the IQ test out as an all-encompassing one, and they started to look at it as a multifaceted.
They added geospatial awareness to
it.
Axis.
Have you ever seen What's-His-Tits shoot the aspirins out of the sky with arrows? So if you know ballistics, which we got a tenuous grasp on, the surface area of the target of an aspirin mathematically does not jive with even a respectable or acknowledgeable amount of possibility, like percentage-wise, of it being a smaller surface area than the impact zone on the projectile. So that plus it moving plus the mechanical transitions between throwing a target, the cognitive transitions between focusing on throwing, understanding parabolic arc and speed, and then drawing an arrow, and then shooting a falling target that is a fraction of the surface area of impact the projectile, and that guy could do it like in his sleep. So there are people that have an understanding of their spatial awareness that is beyond
off
comprehension.
The charts, yeah.
It's just genetic.
Yeah,
there's
because,
very good chance that guy could literally close his eyes and dance a waltz with somebody that he doesn't know where they are in the room, and he's just like, ah, oh, fuck, and like accidentally falls into it.
Wow.
Yeah, it's that's
geospatial reasoning.
Yeah,
because I could see a bullet, like a projectile coming through in the shockwave from the bullet itself hits your target, right? You miss with the bullet. But because it's an aspirin, because it has a certain level of adhesive, the shockwave is going to destroy the aspirin because you've shot an immense amount of energy through that area. Even though the bullet didn't hit it, the aspirin is going to explode. But when you're talking about an arrow, holy shit.
Yeah, a bow is a very like universally hard to measure ballistically. Because there's no ballistic coefficient that can compensate for individual arrows not being manufactured at match grade.
Yeah.
And a person's draw length on a bow that isn't mechanical. It's just, it's a manual draw. So he uses a long bow or a fucking recurve.
Yeah.
So it's not a compound bow with the exact same amount of tension every draw. So this guy is literally winging it and doing something that's mathematically, the probability is astronomically low.
Yeah, that's fucking
scary. He does it over and over and over and over and over. So that's cool as fuck to watch. I dig that dude stuff. I'll go ahead and pretend it's real, whether it is or not, because I know it's possible.
You guys remember what's his face? You'll recognize it. Hold on.
Yeah. Napoleon Dynamite.
Yes.
Is there no standard anymore? What it takes, who I am, where I've been, belong. you can't be something you're not. Be yourself, by yourself. Stay away from me. Any lasting words in life. No, from the dawn of time. Respect. Walk. What did you say? Respect. Walk. Are you talking to me?
He's got a ton of followers, and he gets actually famous bands and other people who say, you know, hey, do this song or do the other song, and he does them, and it's amazing. Here's that WAP song. There's some hoes in this house. There's some
hoes in this house. There's some hoes in this house. I said certified free. 7 days a week. Wet ass but dusty. Make that pullout game weak. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, 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 you friggin' with some wet ass Badoosie. Bring a bucket and a mop for this wet ass Badoosie. Give me everything you got for this wet ass Badoosie.
Who's totally spying on you? Part two. In some cases, apps will passively turn on the microphone in the background and listen in. La Liga, the premier soccer league in Spain, had an app that they were using to basically show people's scores. But it turned on GPS, and when people who were using it went into bars, it would turn on the microphone in the background and listen in to see if a soccer game was playing on TV in the bar. Then it would cross-reference the bar against their database to see if they'd paid the licensing fee to show the game, and if they hadn't, they would find the bar. Now, on one hand, they asked permission to use GPS and the microphone when people installed the app. On the other hand, they didn't tell them what they were using it for, and they never showed them when the microphone was on. So even though apps sometimes will request these permissions, it's really hard to know which ones to trust. And if an app needs those permissions, like say it records video or listens for music.
All right, let's jump right into Little because it's one of my favorites, and it got requested.
Within 24 hours, I've seen ads for boat stuff on Instagram.
Oh my God.
I didn't, like, I have it, like,
yeah. Like, wait a second.
Like, fuck you.
Like,
fuck you.
Hold
all
on,
all
hold
I get,
on.
I'll pull it up right now. All I get are fucking boat ads.
Let's back this up. Let's back this up. Let's do some little analysis here. What did you share on?
Nothing. Nothing. I haven't shared anything on social media about a fucking boat.
Okay, so you
that's
shared.
That's what pisses me off.
You should.
Did you text Amy about it?
Holy
I can actually relate yeah, texted
this.
About it.
Shit.
Yeah, if you've texted about it, then.
And I did a Google search for West Marina once, but I started seeing ads before then.
Yeah, if you texted and talked to somebody about it, and it was.
But here's the thing, though. I was doing searches for boat stuff before I actually owned it. Like, because I was trying to get a feel for different stuff out there, and I wasn't seeing ads for anything boat related or marine related.
Okay.
It wasn't until within 24 hours of owning it. And I don't know what it could have been besides me texting it to people.
I've had a few things like that have happened, but I've just gone ahead and adopted the, if they want to spy on me, that's fine.
It's just annoying.
They can choose however they want to waste their time, because I'll gladly tell them anything and everything I'm up to.
You want to hear something crazy, Doug?
Yeah. The dick pics
so remember how I said that I wanted to play Mario Party out when we were outside?
Yep.
I literally opened up Facebook, and the first ad I saw was for Mario Party on the Nintendo
Fuck
Switch.
Fuck Facebook.
Holy shit.
Never shared anything, never looked anything up for it.
You had Facebook, you deserve it.
Oh, thanks, man. Thanks.
Yeah.
I'm in this generation's classified as old because I have Facebook.
Great question. Here's how we get at it. Take inventory of all the things in your life that suck, all the things that you hate. And for each one of them, if you believe it is anybody else's responsibility to fix it on this planet, you have a victim mentality. In fact, you have worse than a victim mentality. You actually have a very poor perception of the way that the world works, and you're giving your power away. Like if it's something happened to you and now you have depression, right? You didn't cause the depression. It wasn't your fault, but it is your responsibility to deal with it. And if you're waiting for the rest of the world to acquiesce to you to remove your depression, you're a victim. And I'm sorry. I wish I can give you better news, but you're going to stay that way until you change your mind and take responsibility and make your life the way you want it to be. That's how you do it, man. Great question.
That was well said.
Yeah, Brian Chambers is, we're friends on TikTok. He's promoted my stuff. I promoted his stuff. Ex-Army dude, I think. At least that's what I've identified his gear as. He wears kit and works out every day and does a TikTok in his kit. So
TikTok kit.
Flare.
72 million likes on that one. Yeah, this is a
great shot.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the kind of stuff. That,
this is the stuff I follow on Instagram. Someone just having a fucking happy line, you know?
Yeah.
I like how they spray painted the direction of that lip.
Too many people took it to a bad angle.
This is a good steak. It's
That's
prime.
A horrible steak. It would be. What the fuck are you talking about? Look at that thing. That thing is marbled. Like that's.
I thought
fucking,
marble could be a good characteristic to
that's
a steak, though.
Fucking disease.
A little undercooked.
That,
yeah, I would definitely warm that a little further.
That look, the good lean meat is healthy meat, and that's full of fucking fat throughout the muscle, which may taste great because fat tastes great, but.
That's a good point.
Jesus fucking Christ. Fats are also where the toxins are, yeah, yeah, are held. And it's throughout the meat. It's not around the meat. Like
great.
A store.
I'll never
like
get a steak like that now.
Yeah. It's like, Jesus Christ. I don't know. Oh, that's a great steak. Bullshit. From my perspective, it's not.
Number one ain't even a debate. Most animals won't give you problems if you respect their space. Hippos massacre people unprovoked. They can't do math, but they have a bite that can divide you or a crocodile in half. At least 500 obituaries get written a year because a hippo had a temper tantrum.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
So hippos were terrorizing a village.
Yeah, it
in Africa.
It killed a few folks in this one village and actually removed the genitalia of an individual, and it stopped there.
Which is, I'm sorry.
We had a point where a bloke
it bit off his dick and then stopped.
Well, it kind of like thrusted it, probably, right?
He's it, like, it but you munched it off and left. Ooh. It didn't kill him after that, which is like kind of fucked up.
Yeah, they're fucking
wow.
creepy.
Yeah.
We were camping out alongside a river out there, and a bloat of hippos like circled up around us just outside of the light of the fire, so we couldn't see them, but we could hear them clicking and ticking and making that noise. And then we got all like spooked by it, and we started walking away. They were walking around a camp, like just
they're terrifying,
tanks,
man.
Just casual.
They're terrifying. They had to use what they did to. So the two guys that got picked, I guess. So basically, the defense attaché's son was a wildlife guru there, and was trying to help the local village deal with this. So he's like, "All right," well, he's like, "Talk to the village," and he was like, "Hey, I got these guys. They're professional at shooting things accurately at distance," and they're like, "Okay, you can have them." So what they did is they actually staged. This is insane, by the way. So we actually, the two guys I was working with, we gave them one of our guns. It was a 300 Win Mag, I think 220 grain. Mm-hmm. That's not a whole lot of firepower for a hippo, right? You better fucking hit the one spot you can drop a hippo if you're going to do this right. Because if you don't, it's going to just be...
It's going to be angry.
It's going to be a bull in a china shop, and right. The china is people. So here's the thing, is they posted up... on the others, I think they were perpendicular to the water and looking. I think they were actually adjacent, so they could see this village. They were slightly elevated. They were only like a couple hundred yards away, and they got there in the middle of the night. And they like basically had a sniper hide, and they didn't see the hippo until it was in the center of the. I'm talking about like mud huts. Mm-hmm. Until it was in the center of the village, like sniffing around.
Wow.
Which is terrifying because it's the size of a... It's bigger than a hut.
I've never been so off-put by such a large creature.
Yeah.
And, like, we didn't know that they were surrounding us until they were legit from me to the TV.
Wow.
The size of that wall and from me to the
Holy
TV is when I found out they were there.
Shit.
They're that, like,
yeah.
Sneaky.
So they saw it walking in between the huts and they basically picked a spot where they thought it was going to come out. And they dropped it right between the eyes, and it fell right there next to the huts.
Wow.
The villagers came. It was before even the villagers were up and about, because there was just enough sunlight to kind of see visually without, like, thermals or anything.
Yeah.
By the end of the day, the hippo was gone, because they used it.
Yeah, they cannibalized it.
They're like, this is awesome. Like, our problem's gone, and we have meat.
For, like, 10 years for that village, probably.
Yeah.
Salt that up, dry it up. Jerky. Hippo jerky.
That was an op I wanted.
Yeah, all right, so fun, anyway, right? That's a peek at TikTok and what's going on that social media site. You might want to check it out because it's got some amazing stuff, including my stuff. Follow Mind Hacking Happiness on TikTok for your mind tips and tricks and a latest series that I started doing on spiritual enlightenment and how to achieve spiritual enlightenment and the science behind spiritual enlightenment. So there you go. Hope this message finds you well. Talk to you guys soon. Peace.
Deuces! And a walrus.